Namaste to all. I welcome you all to W4C. I sincerely hope you would enjoy the conference. Would be happy to have your feedback and suggestions. You can write to me at our official email.
morning, Sudhir. Very warm good morning on 24th October, our finale day of the conference. We begin with our morning plenary session. I will introduce the chairpersons for the same. Dr. Khalid Shukri, Chair, Neurocritical Care Society, President of Transcontinental Elite Alliance for Intensive Care, Saudi Arabia. Dr. D.K. Singh, the Founder, Executive Director of AIMS, Bhatinda. Dr. G.C. Khilnani, Chairman, PSRI Institute of Pulmonary Critical Care and Sleep Medicine, PSRI Hospital, New Delhi. I welcome our other chairpersons, Dr. K.K. Parikh. He is the Senior Consultant in Medicine and Director, K.K. Parikh Hospital, Rajasthan. Dr. Rakesh Tyagi, Director, Department of Critical Care Medicine, Synergy Plus Hospital, Agra. Dr. Lalit Raigar, he is the Additional Principal, R&T Medical College, Rajasthan. Has any of the chairpersons, is there any of the chairpersons live?
Dr. Lalit is live, ma'am.
Dr. Lalit Raigar, please introduce the speaker.
Dr. Ross Priben is working as an intensive care consultant, Hawke's Bay Hospital in Hastings, and he is currently president of Asia Pacific Association of Critical Care, as well as he was past president, College of Intensive Care Medicine. In his name, he is an adjunct associate professor at the Chinese University, Hong Kong, and medical director for New Zealand Air Ambulance Services. Over to you.
Thank you for inviting me to talk about something that I'm very interested in, which is oxygen therapy. I just want to start by talking about my declarations of interest, none of which have particular relevance to this talk, but oxygen is a clear, odorless molecule. There's in our atmosphere at 21%, and is used widely in therapies and has been used for many years. 90 to 95% of the oxygen that we consume is used in simple oxidative phosphorylation, providing energy to our cells. And the other 5% is used in mixed function oxidases and super radical formation. Perhaps this is the area in which we're most interested, but it is the smallest part of what oxygen does. Just before I want to start, I'd just like to say that when in doubt, give oxygen. We may talk later on about the dangers of oxygen toxicity, but in the short term, hypoxemia is the most dangerous thing we have. Oxygen therapy is used widely in the critically ill. The current standard is to titrate therapy to either oxygen tension of between 55 to 80 millimeters of mercury or between 88 and 95%. During this COVID epidemic, we found that achieving this may be difficult, but certainly the attempt is always to get the oxygen in the mid-range rather than the higher range. But in actual practice, there may be a huge clinical variance. Now, oxygen delivery is the to the tissues is the oxygen content times the cardiac output. The oxygen content is made up of the hemoglobin, the saturations, and the amount of dissolved oxygen. Surprises some people realize that the oxygen carried by hemoglobin comprises about 197 mL per litre, while that carried in dissolved oxygen is only 3 mL per litre. So doubling our PO2 will only increase the oxygen content by a small amount, while raising the saturation increases it by a large amount. I want you to consider a critically ill patient with respiratory failure on a ventilator in ICU. They're stable on support on appropriate treatment. Now, let's consider the changes in delivery of oxygen to the tissues. If there's a drop in hemoglobin from 125 to 90 grams per litre, we would be a little concerned, but perhaps take no action, given that our threshold for transfusion is usually about 70 or perhaps a little bit higher. If there's a drop in cardiac output from 6 litres to 5 litres per minute, again, we would be concerned but perhaps take no action. However, if there was a drop in saturation from 95 to 85%, we would all take immediate action to improve that oxygenation. It's worth considering that the drop in oxygen delivery to the tissues with a drop in hemoglobin was 24%, yet we weren't that concerned. A drop in cardiac output is 17%. But the drop in saturation that stimulated us to take action was only an 11% change. Therefore, we react quite strongly to changes in oxygenation when perhaps we should consider the overall picture more widely. So how do we increase oxygenation? Well, getting oxygen in is usually achieved by increasing FiO2, and that's, in many cases, that's all we do, enrich the oxygen that the patient is breathing. In other circumstances, we can raise the mean alveolar pressure. We do this on a ventilator by increasing the tidal volume, increasing the pause time, changing the IE ratio, or increasing the PEEP. PEEP has the added effect of reopening alveoli and therefore decreasing shunt fraction, as well as raising the mean alveolar pressure to improve oxygenation. And we can use recruitment maneuvers to reopen alveoli and decrease the shunt fraction. But increasing tidal volume, increasing the pause time, increasing the inspiratory time, increasing the PEEP, and recruiting the patient increases intrathoracic pressure. Raising the intrathoracic pressure decreases venous return, and this therefore decreases cardiac output. So if the cardiac output is decreased, but the oxygenation is increased, does this decrease or increase the delivery of oxygen to the tissues? So if you think about this, why don't we just increase the FiO2? This is a study that's 4 years old now. It was published in the JAMA, and it looked at the effect of recruitment maneuvers and titration of PEEP against a standard low PEEP strategy. The ART study was notable in that it actually appeared, the intervention appeared to increase mortality, despite the fact that the lung recruitment and titration of PEEP appear to improve oxygenation. So why don't we just turn the oxygen up? Well, there are changes in the tissues as a result of oxygenation. This is an animal model done by Opera in 1979, and it shows that after using 100% oxygen, on the right, you can see this denudation of the loss of the cilia and the bronchial surfaces of this mouse using high concentrations of oxygen. The oxygen itself appeared to do harm. There are multiple ways, and I'm not going to explain this slide, there are multiple ways where high concentrations of oxygen can cause hyperoxic lung damage and damage to other organs. This is a complex slide, and I don't want to confuse myself or you by talking about it further, but just realise there are a lot of ways superoxide radicals can harm the tissues. But more oxygen must be better for us, surely. Well, maybe not. This is data from the ARDSnet study done in 1998, which looked at the difference between 12 mL per kilogram and 6 mL per kilogram of tidal volume. It was a seminal paper, and it demonstrated a reduction in mortality in those patients that received 6 mL per kilogram. However, if you looked at the oxygenation in the first 4 days, we'd realise that the 6 mL per kilogram had lower oxygenation parameters than those in the 12 mL per kilogram. In the short term, if we'd be using oxygenation as an outcome, we would have thought that the high tidal volume ventilation was better. And we know that high tidal volume does improve oxygenation, but may not make outcomes better. So the mortality in the 12 mL per kilogram group was 39%. And only 31% in the low volume group. There are those situations where oxygen could cause harm. Back in 1976, patients with uncomplicated myocardial infarction had a high mortality and more VT when they received oxygen compared to those that received air. And in 2009, again, larger infarcts and reduced survival was seen when routine oxygen sublimation was used. This is the AVOID study, which looked at troponin as a marker of myocardial injury. It was published in 2015. And you can see that over time, those in the oxygen arm had higher early rises in troponin compared to those getting no oxygen. Kilgannon raised the issue of association between acute arterial hyperoxia and following resuscitation from cardiac arrest and outcome. And they thought that patients with non-traumatic cardiac arrest, there's an association between the first PO2 and the first blood gas mortality. A high PO2 was associated with an increased mortality, as was a low PO2. But normoxia appeared to be the ideal circumstance. All this concern about the effects of oxygen, high concentrations of oxygen in patients that have been resuscitated, led to a number of studies being conducted. This study by Gerardis, published in 2016, looked at ventilated patients in ICU. The ICU mortality in these patients was different between those in the conservative and conventional group, and that was statistically significant. And there was a reduction in the number of hours being ventilated in the conventional group. So this suggests that there is something in the conservative use of oxygen. Reduction in oxygen seemed to decreased mortality, but there was a change in the mechanical free hours as well. This is the data over time. Conservative oxygen therapy, there appeared to be an improved survival compared to conventional oxygen therapy. There were some problems with this trial, the issues that people raised. It was a single center trial. The trial was stopped early due to unplanned interim analysis following a natural disaster and the need to move the study site. The intention to treat analysis excluded early deaths. If the patient died before 72 hours, that patient was excluded from the study. And this may have influenced the results. And also there was a concern about the neuropsychiatric outcomes from patients who were exposed to low oxygen therapies. Despite this, there was a number of popular press publications suggesting that oxygen kills people, and this made the headlines on several occasions when studies were being done. This systemic review and meta-analysis provided high-quality evidence that hyperoxia may in fact be life-threatening. We looked at a large number of studies, a large number of patients being studied, and suggested that increased oxygen was to increase your risk of dying. However, when you looked at the long-term neurological outcomes from patients who have been exposed to hypoxemia in patients, this may paint a different picture. This is the long-term cognitive impairment results from the FACTS study, when Mickelson looked to see what happens when patients were subjected to quite subtle errors of hypoxemia. Patients that were exposed to a low partial peripheral arterial oxygen during the trial associated with a cognitive and psychiatric impairment that was worse than those that didn't. This was quite a small difference in arterial oxygen overall, but it does suggest that perhaps if you're going to go home and survive, it's important that you end up with your cognitive and psychiatric faculties, and so you're not just a burden upon society. So this raised a number of questions. As a result of this, the ICROC study was developed. This is a trial looking at patients who have been ventilated for less than 2 hours in intensive care, and the idea is that they would be allocated to either a conservative or standard care group. The conservative group, where they would target reduction in oxygen below SATs of 95%, and the standard care, which will be the standard care provided in that unit, where oxygen was less rigorously chased. We can see in the overall results, there was a separation in the oxygen parameters in those patients. The patients in the standard care group received a higher concentration of oxygen compared to the others. And this was published, this study was published in 2019. There were 3,000 patients screened for it, of which a third of them were excluded, and another 1,500 were eligible but missed the window, which resulted in only 1,000 patients of the 3,300 being enrolled. The overall effect was there didn't appear to be any significant difference between the outcome in these patients, the survival characteristics of these patients, those receiving usual oxygen and those receiving conserved oxygen therapy. As a result of this and encouragement from other studies, it's been decided to conduct a 40,000 patient mega trial looking at the same protocol essentially to comparing conservative versus liberal oxygen targets. So the question is, why was ICU ROX equivocal? Why could we not demonstrate it? Well, it could be that oxygen has no harmful effects. That's entirely possible. It's not supported, however, by the animal or human data that suggests there is a harmful effect of high concentrations of oxygen. It was unblinded, and maybe there was a bias towards those patients that were receiving lower concentrations of oxygen that were looked after better or some other effect. It's impossible to say, but it's unlikely the clinicians would act differently, and it's also, in many of the circumstances, clinicians were really unaware, despite being unblinded, which arm they were in. It could be a dose effect. Hyperoxia and hypoxia are rare, and many of the patients received low FiO2s, and therefore the effect of increased oxygen concentration would be small, if at all. It may also be that they weren't sick enough, they weren't ventilated for long enough, and 3 days of exposure overall was not enough to see any change in mortality. The study may have been too small, and MegaROX is designed to address this issue. 1,000 patients, although large by ICU trials, is small by overall epidemiological trials that are done in other disciplines, including cardiology. The other reason that ICU ROX may be equivocal is the peri-trial oxygen exposure. It wasn't controlled for. The patients received oxygen prior to and immediately after their ventilation, and this was not controlled or even measured. So patients could be exposed to high concentrations of oxygen before, put in the conservative group, and then received high concentrations immediately afterwards. Another study that was published in 2021 is a hot ICU study and looked again at high oxygenation and lower oxygenation groups. And these patients, 60% of them roughly were ventilated. The rest was receiving some form of oxygen therapy, and they were allocated to a higher or lower oxygenation group. And again, there was no difference in mortality or other outcomes from the study. So I suggested that the periventilation, high flow nasal oxygen support may have influenced the outcome of the MegaROX study. This is very common in New Zealand, where patients who enrolled in the MegaROX and the ROX study were, that high flow nasal cannula is commonly used. I want to talk now about other techniques we use for oxygenation, in particular non-invasive techniques. Non-invasive techniques may be useful in COPD, cardiogenic pulmonary edema, asthma, post-op extubation. They're useful when there's increased work of breathing and respiratory fatigue, but they're not particularly useful in hypoxemia. However, high-flow nasal cannula is useful in hypoxic respiratory failure. In this patient, this study by Fratt and others, published in 2015, clearly demonstrates the benefit of using high flow nasal oxygen in patients with hypoxic respiratory failure. You can see here, this is the cumulative probability of survival in patients who had over time. And you can see that standard oxygen and non-invasive ventilation did worse than those that received high flow oxygen by nasal cannula. Now, traditional oxygen therapy can be delivered in a number of ways. You can see here low flow nasal prongs, simple face mask, humidified high flow mask, Venturi mask, and rebreather mask. These are variable performance devices. What happens with a variable performance device is, although you breathe in 100% oxygen, you also, at the start of ventilation, you entrain air as well. And so as your inspiratory flow increases, you entrain more and more air. In this case, if it's 30 litres, 24 litres of air has been entrained with 100% oxygen, meaning your aspired oxygen concentration is 37%. By matching the, this is shown, this data shows the same effect as when a low flow nasal cannula is given at 4 liters per minute. Once the inspiratory flow exceeds the 4 liters, a lot of the air is entrained. If we were to give high flows of nasal cannula at a known FiO2, all the air that is breathed in will be at that known FiO2. It allows us to provide higher concentrations of oxygen. The high-flow nasal cannula system, in this case the Airvo OptiFlow system, requires three things. It requires the delivery of high-flow nasal gas, which is at a controlled FiO2. It requires it to be water bath humidified so it doesn't cause excoriation of the nasal area. It is these prongs that are important. The soft fit in the nose and allow the delivery of high flows of gas to the back of the throat. Not only do these deliver high concentrations of oxygen at high flows, they also cause a pressure effect. This paper by Park showing that with high flow oxygen, this is in a single patient, this is standard oxygen, the red line, there's no change in pressure as the patient breathes in and out. Using high flow at 35 litres per minute, the pressure in the back of the throat can be raised. In other words, there's a small amount of CPAP or PEEP effect keeping the lungs open during inspiration. We can see that high flow oxygen therapy can actually I just have to stop again now. Sorry. Just delete something out of this. We can see this pressure effect occurring here. The high flow nasal cannula in this person going underwater has been delivered to the back of the throat. The pressure is sufficient so that when the diver opens his mouth, gas comes out rather than goes in. So the high flow nasal cannula aren't delivering not just oxygen, but pressure to the back of the throat. And then this improves oxygen. So getting oxygen in is dependent upon the FiO2, but also the mean alveolar pressure. And we can do this by increasing the tidal volume and increasing the PEEP. And the high-flow nasal cannula do this. High-flow nasal cannula allows to control FiO2, increase the airway pressure, and apply positive expiratory pressure, and therefore probably decrease shunt fraction. They also reduce the dead space. So this ramble through oxygenation. Hypoxia is bad, and we know that. We should avoid it at all costs. Hyperoxia may or may not be bad, but it's probably not good for us. Inspired oxygen should be titrated down as long as there's no attributable negative consequences. And there's no real place for maintaining higher levels simply just in case as prophylactic measures. The lower target of oxygenation is unclear. Many patients will tolerate considerably less values of PO2 than have been traditionally accepted. And COVID has demonstrated that quite adequately. But there are concerns about the long-term subtle neurological outcomes for these patients. And if you're going to lower the oxygen saturations, you need to require robust monitoring to ensure the patient doesn't come to harm in the short term. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone, once again. Dr. K.K. Parikh has joined our session today, and I now request him to take over and introduce our next speaker.
Hello. Hello.
Good morning, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Should I?
Yes, sir. Please.
Yes. Thank you very much. At the outset, I thanks and extend my gratitude to Dr. Roongta for giving me this opportunity to be a part of this very successful, very educational, and very meaningful conference, World Congress on COVID. The topic, next topic is COVID, the immunocompromised patient. The experience of Dr. Devithia. Dr. Devithia is professor and head department of anesthesia. The first lecture is by Dr. Devithia. Yes, am I right? The first lecture?
Yes, sir. Next.
No, I'm...
as per list, this is by Dr. B.K. Rao.
B.K. Rao, okay, sorry. So the topic is secondary infection in COVID patients, which we have been seeing very commonly in our day-to-day practice. The Dr. B.K. Rao is one of the learned critical care specialists, and is chairman and senior consultant department of critical care medicine, Sir Gangaram Hospital, Delhi. He's an antimicrobial stalwart ship program chairman, SGRH, Indian Council of Medical Research, and co-chairperson expansion of AMSP and IPC of ICMR in secondary care hospital. He's a very learned and a very tallest personality in infection diseases. So I invite Dr. B.K. Rao for his lecture.
Good morning, friends. I will take a moment to thank the organizers for inviting me to speak about something which is not only, or which had not only relevance to the COVID pandemic time, it is going to have a relevance in years to come because of what we did during the COVID time. What I'm going to be talking about is the secondary infections in COVID-19 patients. What we have to understand is that one was the SARS-CoV-2, and the second thing was how we managed it. How we managed it was different between different hospitals, different physicians, different cities, different countries. Everything was related to the manpower you had, the resources you had, and the magnitude or the disease load that you had. So we know that we were struggling. We were putting in a whole lot of non-ICU staff to take care of this. We were having unusually long ventilator days or the ICU admission days. So all that had a bearing on the secondary infections. And it is not surprising that we are getting secondary infections, which are quite different between different geographical regions of the world. The second thing that causes ambiguity is the difference between a co-infection and a secondary infection. We know that the co-infection is what you came with, and secondary infection is what you got during the treatment after hospitalization. But COVID was a unique situation. We had a lot of movement between hospitals, between wards and ICUs, and most of the reports or most of the studies have not mentioned the time sampling was done and the time they have received the reports of microbiological cultures. So there is ambiguity between these two, and it has a significance because as we see in this study where they were looking at a co-infection, because they took the samples within the first 48 hours and they were looking at respiratory samples, this was pneumonia, they found that in the ICU patients, in a French ICU in fact, they had an infection rate which was as high as 28%. So it has a lot of significance. If this one to get labeled as a secondary infection, then the secondary levels or infection levels will go up. Similarly, we found another study. This is again a single center study from Chicago, a small study, but they found between the wall and ICU patients, the infection rate in the, and these are again co-infections, was as high as 41%. And if that be so, then these amount of infections will skew the data of the secondary infections as we see in the literature. Not only that, we have ambiguity between what is co-infection and secondary infection and whether the studies actually grab the in co-infection separately or they mix co-infection with the secondary infections. We also have studies where the clinical and laboratory parameters were very, very different. And it's difficult to, you know, club them together for a review article or maybe later on for a meta-analysis. We also know that at least in the resource-limited countries, the number of investigations that were sent was quite low for various reasons. I'm not going there. And because they were wearing PPEs, the IPC practices went for a toss. The hand wash was far in between. And since the trained manpower was not there in the ICUs, at least, we know that there should have been a contamination of the sampling rates, though it is not exactly documented or it is not only not also reported in the literature. But this was reported by Bhatt in their study when they studied four samples, one after the other, they were taken first sample, second, third, and fourth. And they said that there is an chance of a co-infection, contamination, and they quantified it. And this they did by looking at the culture consistency that they were getting, the bacterial sensitivity, the bacterial reports that they were getting in these samples, the consistency they had, and whether there was any evidence of bacteremia or not. When it was not there, they called it a contaminant. And this is a significant level of contamination if we were to look at contamination. If you look at all the studies, in the timelines that they have done, there is one which have limited themselves to the COVID cohorts only. There are some which have studied all. So they have studied the pre-pandemic time. They have studied the pandemic time, including only the COVID or including COVID and non-COVID. Let's look at some of these studies. But first, let's look at the co-infection. As I was giving you earlier, this is the co-infection study taken in the first 48 hours. Infection rates 28%. Not surprisingly, the bacteria that they got, we see them in community acquired infections very often. In this one, the incidence of or the usage of antibiotic was as high as 92%. And the authors felt that if you have an incidence of 28%, then giving 92% or giving antibiotics to 92% patients was quite okay. But let's not forget that not everybody had the infection. So somewhere we think that somebody got undertreated, somebody got overtreated, you know, those kind of permutations and combinations that we are thinking of. Let's look at another study from Chong. It was a review article of 49 studies. They also reported the fungal infection rates to be lower than the bacterial infection rates. And this is what usually comes out around 16%. And they also said that in the light of these infections, the population that was being treated received 60 to 100% of them received antibiotics. So certainly a rate which does not match the infection rates. So this is one of the things that we are looking at. Let's look at now another study. This one came from Caritas. They looked now at the time to fight. They looked at the pre-pandemic, they looked at the pandemic, and they looked at the negative patients and the positive patients. The COVID positive patients are in the red. What is very clear here is that in certain cases, the infection rates went up in the COVID patients, not so much in the non-COVID patients. So they were matching, but the red ones were not. And the most striking was this, the acinetobamide. They suddenly found a very high rate of acinetobamide. And they looked at then where was it coming from. And they found that it was coming mainly from the respiratory. So 3% to 9%, a huge jump when it came to the acinetobamide in patients who were COVID positive. But when we look at those who are not COVID positive, that means those pre-pandemic, this one is the pandemic, but COVID negative, this is pre-pandemic, there was not much of a difference between these two. The difference was in the COVID patients. And another difference they found was that the ESBL producing enterobacterials, their incidence went down. And surprisingly, the carbapenem resistance went up. This is a very interesting finding, which I could not get in any other study. Pasquini also looked at the same thing. They looked at, again, the pre-pandemic and the pandemic. The pre-pandemic was usually 3 to 4 months before the pandemic started to give a good match. And what they also looked at is when you look the all patients and before pandemic and the all patients during pandemic, the change was not much. If you look at the COVID negative patients alone in the pandemic and compare that with the pre-pandemic, then also the change is not very stark. But if you look at the COVID positive patients, then compare them with the pre-pandemic, then you find a very, very significant change coming up. The incidence was going up. So one thing that stands out in all these studies is that the incidence of infection in the pandemic, in the COVID patients, COVID positive patients, was on the rise. Then, but also looked at other things. We usually send multiple samples. They were looking at a bloodstream infection, so they were sending 4 samples. What they found was that the maximum positivity was in the flush blood culture, and that too, again, mainly the bacterial, few in the fungal. Surprisingly, with the passage of time, the positivity went down. Not that we see very often. And then they had a high cons. And this is what they were referring to when they were talking of the contaminants in the blood collection samples that they had done. Let's look at another aspect of the study. What about severity? Does it change the incidence of secondary infection? Does it really change the practice of critical care or the practice of COVID management? Yes, it did. Let's look at this study. It came from 3 cities in China. Fang, the author. And what they did and clearly showed was that as the severity of the infection goes up, so does the infection rates. These are secondary infections in COVID positive patients, overall 8.5 going up to 35. But if you look at the moderate and severe, then we are not bad. They are below or equal to the average. Not surprisingly, the antibiotic usage also was the maximum in this group, which is the critical, and it reached as high as 92%. So this is where, it stands out that the severity of the disease was handled and seen differently than what we saw in the other patients. Let's look at one of the, let's come back to India now. So we look at one of the study that came from All India Institute, Delhi. They had a large study. It was 1,179 patients. They found that 52 or maybe more patients were sterile, samples were sterile. They reported as secondary infection of 13%. 2/3 of that was in the non-ICU. Normally we see ICU having more, but this was largely because they were having ward and ICU patient population, and the non-ICU was much, much more than the ICU. In fact, ICU had just about 1/3 of the population. And they found that what they found was that the main etiological pathogen was the bacteria, fungus was in little, they found no virus, and they found one mycoplasma again in the ETR ball. What were the bacteria? The same casual, these usual ones, the Klebsiella, Acinetobacter, E. coli, Pseudomonas. And these are the ones that have been coming up consistently in all the studies, except the one which limited themselves to the co-infections or to the comorbidity infections in the COVID-19 patient. So that's the relevance of that. Let's look at another study, since we said fungus was very little, but that was not so always. In mucormycosis, India probably topped the world. You know, we gained notoriety because of that. We, according to the Ministry of Health, 7th June data, we had over 28,000 mucormycosis patients. It's a notifiable disease in India. Two states, Maharashtra and the Gujarat, had the maximum patients. 86% of them were from the COVID and a strong association with diabetes. And a group of diabetologists looked at 101 patients, and they reported that 81% of them were from India. So though the overall fungal load was less, the secondary infections due to fungal were less, but that was not so with mucormycosis. That is where we were getting inundated with this particular fungus. We did another study, and this time it was done by ICMR. ICMR is the apex research organization of India, the Indian Council of Medical Research. They have satellite centers, they have surveillance network centers, and that is where the study was done. And what they looked at was, again, secondary infections. The population came from the ICUs and ward, and the period was from June to August. These are the 10 centers. This is where I belong to. We contributed to this study. I was one of the co-authors in this. And if you look at the Indian map, then from east to west, north to south, and in the center, five states were represented and two union territories in the red star. These are the union territories were represented. So it was a very good sample coming from across the whole length and breadth of India. And these are premier institutions. So these are very mature centers where we expected good quality data to come from. Who all participated? All those who were involved in the care of the COVID patients were involved. What did we look at? Mainly the microbiological and the antimicrobial resistance data. But we also looked at the demographic, the time of infection, and the clinical outcome on these patients. What did we find? What we found was this. Bloodstream infection, respiratory infection are the most common secondary infections. Out of the 1,006 isolates, 41% came from blood and 35 came from the respiratory. In the isolates, again, what dominated were the GNBs. Again, Klebsiella, Acinetobacter, Pseudomonas, E. coli, and the other GNBs that we had. We had a sprinkle of gram-positive enterococcus. We did have the cons. I wish we could relook at that and see how many of them were actually contaminants. But we found Candida in the blood and Aspergillus in the respiratory samples. So this is as far as the etiological pathogens are concerned. Then we looked at the AMR data, because we are talking of the AMR surveillance centers, so they could get this data quite well. What did we find? Let's look at Klebsiella, because Klebsiella and Acinetobacter dominated the scene. Let's look at Klebsiella. Look at that. It starts from 70% and goes right up to 90%. And if you look at the sensitivity, the blue ones, then we find that the only saving grace we had was in tigecycline. Otherwise, the red ones are the resistant. They were all pretty high. Look at the Acinetobacter. That was worse than Klebsiella also. If you look at these red bars, that is where the resistance was. They are almost touching 100%. They're all above 90%. The only saving grace again here in this case was the minocycline. So we are looking at two main bugs, main bacteria, coming up in the secondary infections, and both of them having very, very high resistance. So it was expected that though we had high incidence or high rate of antibiotic usage, our antibiotics will also belong to the reserve category. That was our fear, and that is what we wanted to collect. And surprisingly, when we look at the three categories as classified by the WHO, we had the majority of them falling into the access and the watch category, which is okay. We had reserve category antibiotics also, like polymyxins, colistin, meropenem, minocycline, tigecycline, things like that. And but they were still contained. I mean, I know we were, you know, these are 10 referral centers. So by the time they got the patients, a whole lot of them would have been infected and would have been on a whole lot of antibiotics. So we were forced to at times to use these antibiotics, but we are still not through the roof, at least when it comes to the reserve antibiotics. That is what we are, you know, we are happy about. What we are not happy about is this. They're not recommended, a sizable amount of that. I'm not quantifying not recommended. It could be various reasons, but it certainly highlights the point that antimicrobial stewardship program took a big hit in the times of COVID. Had it been there, we will see this as a speck and not as a tall building or tall bar like that. So that is, again, what our study clearly brings out, that antimicrobial stewardship program was missing, and that is what has to be put in place, not only in the COVID time, but even in the non-COVID times. What else did we see in this study? We had 17,000 patients, over 17,000, one of the largest studies in the world. We had patients between 40 to 70 years. The second infection is coming up by the 7th or 10th day. Our infection, secondary infection rates were low overall. So if we look at the secondary infections, then it varied from as low as 0.4% going up to 28.5%. And that is what I said, that these practices differed between institutions and had an impact on the secondary infection. But one very prominent thing is that whereas the overall mortality in COVID was 10.6, if you look at the subset where secondary infections were there, 5 times. So that was the importance of secondary infection in our study, that if you have it, then the mortality rate will shoot. I mean, in our study, it was more than 5 times. So that is where the preventive IPC practices play a great role, and they must be put in place. So to summarize our study, we reported an incidence of 3.6. 78% of them were GNBs. Klebsiella and Acinetobacter were dominating, had a very high incidence of resistance. We had fungus and other infections also, but they were still manageable. And we had a high mortality in those who had secondary infections in COVID. So coming back to what we've learned or what we have seen in the world literature, I scanned through it. And what one thing is very clear that, you know, these studies were planned on the go, as we say. They were not planned earlier. They were not planned very well. We did not have the targets in sight. We kept collecting data as it came. I think if we were to do that, in at least in those parts where COVID is still raging or still present, and we don't know whether it's going to come back in, even in our country, the planned study should include the targets. What is the risk population? What is the outcome? How does it change with the interventions that we do in the ICUs or in the wards? How does it change with the quality of care that we give to these people? Again, MDR is a big issue. So there has to be IPC, has to be in place, the infection prevention and control practices. We must put in place the AMR, the AMSPs, the antimicrobial stewardship programs. And we still have a supportive treatment, so still a lot needs to be done. We must find a curative drug, a drug which can cure COVID, and also the vaccines. Probably, at present, they are our saviors. So, ladies and gentlemen, friends, that's where I end with a very clear message that secondary infection is a reality. It is a killer. It is a risk factor when it comes to the mortality. And it is something that can be manageable if we look after the antimicrobial stewardship program and if we look after the infection prevention and control practices. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Rao, for a very masterly presentation. It has been, you have talked very nicely about the secondary infection, what is co-infection and what is the secondary infection, and the incidence of mucormycosis fungal infection was very, very high in India, and it was not very well treated also, what the studies say. But as you said, the secondary infection was very, very common in COVID infections, and we should take care of the secondary infection rightly after culture and sensitivity test. So it was a very masterly presentation. Thank you so much, Dr. Rao, and congratulations.
Sir, can Dr. Rungta here, sir? Thank you very much for a wonderful presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Can I ask a question, sir?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Rao, as the literature is coming up now about the post-COVID infections or COVID secondary infections in various countries, there is a vast difference between pre-hospital infection rate and post-hospital infection rate in Western countries. But it is amazingly high in our country. And the organisms detected there are, you know, so different. In our country, the secondary infection is mostly reported with hospital-associated infection organisms like Acinetobacter, mostly Acinetobacter, I would say. So, and in Western countries, whatever literature has come, they say it is Haemophilus or Staph aureus, they have detected pneumococcus in few patients. Even in China, the incidence of hospital-associated infection has not been reported very high. What is your take about it, sir?
No, I was not clear about the question. The question is that why incidence is high in India?
One, the pre-hospital and post-hospital is almost, pre-hospital is almost the same in our country also. That is, community-acquired infection is almost the same in Western countries, in our country, incidence. But after hospitalization in ICU, their incidence is around somewhere around 12-14%. And our incidence is anywhere around 50%. Their organisms are mostly related to community infections. Our infections are mostly related to hospital-acquired infections. They have not reported any Acinetobacter, but whatever information I could gather, most of our infections reported are gram-negative and mostly Acinetobacter.
In the pre-COVID time also, the problem India faces and the challenge we face is GNB. Gram positive is not such a big challenge for us. And things have worsened even for those who were non-COVID. Because our study showed that in the non-COVID patients also, the incidence of infections went up. We are talking of the secondary infections. It depends on whether you are collecting the co-infection separately or not. If you club it with the secondary infection, you will find Haemophilus influenza, Staph pneumoniae, you know, those community acquired bugs, you will collect and report in the secondary infection. Whereas fact is that they were not secondary infections. You collected them in one bag. And that is where the co-infections and the secondary infections got mixed up. But essentially, it is the GNB in our country. We do have a challenge because in our study, 25% of the patients received the gram-positive coverage as well. So it's not that gram-positive is not there, but the challenge is gram-negative because that is where the huge resistance is coming up. Have I answered that, Dr. Rungta?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes.
Thank you.
You have already emphasized about our, we should stress on hospital associated infection prevention.
Yes.
That is important.
So any other question from the audience? So should I conclude this talk? Thank you, Dr. Rao.
Thank you, sir.
Should I introduce him or
somebody? Yes, sir.
So, our next topic by Dr. J.V. Devatia, COVID, the immunocompromised patient. What is his experience? We know Dr. Devatia is a professor and head department of anesthesia, critical care and pain, Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai, and he is past president of ISCCM, past editor-in-chief on India Journal of Anesthesia, and he has a great publications, more than 158 publications. He's a very learned person and masterly person about intensive care and critical care. So I invite Dr. Devatia, please start your topic.
Thank you very much for asking me to speak at this very prestigious meeting. I will be speaking on COVID-19 and the immunosuppressed patient, my experience. And because I work in the Tata Memorial Hospital, which is the tertiary referral cancer center for India with over 750 beds, my experience with immunosuppressed patients and COVID-19 has actually been confined to patients with cancer. And so with your permission, I will speak on COVID-19 and cancer. Now, we know this is the pathophysiology of COVID-19 as we know of it today. So you initially have the incubation phase when the viremia is at its peak, the oxygen saturation is reasonably well maintained, and then the patient starts getting symptomatic. And that's when the level of viremia actually starts reducing as the inflammatory response of the body keeps mounting and attempt to combat the infection. And at some point, usually around 7 to 10 to 12 days after the initial onset of symptoms, you find that the level of virus, the viremia has gone down, but the inflammatory response keeps mounting. And that's when the patient may either get into what we are now calling as the hyperinflammatory phase of infection. So the patient may actually have a pulmonary infection either during the viremic phase, or they may get pulmonary problems during the inflammatory phase. And as the inflammation keeps increasing, you might find that the hyperinflammation actually sets in, and that's when you can actually get even more complications, including the acute respiratory distress syndrome and worsening organ dysfunction. Okay. So essentially, you have an early viremic phase and midterm to a late inflammatory phase. And we just need to keep this in mind when we are discussing what happens to the cancer patient when he or she gets COVID-19. Now, we know that comorbidities are a significant factor in the outcome of COVID-19, and that patients with severe comorbidities do worse when they get COVID-19. And in this very nice review, it was found that these are the four comorbidities which actually impact on severity and outcome of COVID-19. So these are, of course, well-known: hypertension, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and cancer. So cancer is a significant problem if a patient has got COVID-19, or if a cancer patient gets COVID-19, that can become a significant problem as far as the patient is concerned. Now, why is that? I mean, there are several reasons why patients with cancer and COVID-19 may not do too well. One is patients with cancer are often elderly, and they often have comorbidities associated with age, including heart disease, including COPD, diabetes, hypertension, which are well-known risk factors anyway. More importantly, cancer itself may be an immunosuppressive disease, and hematological malignancies are known to cause immunosuppression. And that can increase, maybe increase the propensity for infection and maybe increase the severity of infection. And we'll deal with many of these issues as we go along. Treatment of cancer with chemotherapy and other agents can further lead to suppression of immunity, and that can also make the disease worse. And potentially, it can amplify the viremic phase, and that could make give rise to a more severe disease. Cancer patients often have decrease in physical and cognitive function. They have treatment-related toxicities, and they also may have other organ dysfunction, including cardiovascular, renal, and respiratory dysfunction. Now, this is a population-based study in a region of Italy, and here they tested almost 84,000 patients for SARS-CoV-2. 9,275 turned out to be positive, and 7.5% of these had prior or current cancer. However, what they found was that the prevalence of cancer was not associated with an increased risk of infection, but hospitalizations and mortality were higher in cancer patients. The mortality in patients with cancer was 14.7%. It was three times more than if a patient did not have cancer. So cancer certainly seems to predispose to more severe infection, more hospitalizations, and more deaths in patients with COVID-19. And in this pooled meta-analysis, 52 studies, almost 100,000 patients, almost 94 lakh patients. They found that the pooled odds ratio for mortality amongst patients with cancer and COVID-19 was 25.6%. So that's pretty high. So it's quite clear that amongst patients with COVID-19, those who have cancer have worse outcomes as compared to those who do not have cancer. What are the determinants of COVID-19 and cancer mortality? So amongst patients with COVID-19 and cancer, what are the determinants of mortality? And this review actually looked at all the major registries which were in force at that time. And these included the American CCC, you had the Italian registry, you had the Terravolt or the thoracic cancers registry, you had the French registry, you had the another French registry, and the CCC, and you had the UK CCMP for COVID and related diseases. So you had all these major registries. And when they looked at the data from all these registries, they found that the male sex, smoking was significant. Progressive cancer versus cancer in remission in the US registry was actually very significant. So maybe that was that's something that can predict outcome. Increasing age, of course, was highly predictive of mortality in all the registries. A performance status, the ECOG performance status, which was worse, again predicted mortality. But very intriguingly, hematologic malignancy, as opposed to solid tumors, did not figure in any of these data as a predictive factor for mortality in cancer. So what the original impression that hematological malignancies may make the patient, those patients more vulnerable for severity and mortality, did not seem to be borne out by this initial data from the various registries. Also, only one registry from France, the Gustave Roussy registry, found that cytotoxic therapy in the past 3 months, so recent chemotherapy, was found to be predictive of a worse outcome in only one of the many databases. So there seems to be some data which does not back the perception that hematologic malignancies may be more prone to severe disease and death. If you look at just patients with hematological malignancies and COVID-19, there is very nice systematic review and meta-analysis. And here it showed that adults had a higher mortality than children, 34% versus 4%. So children with hematologic malignancies actually did pretty well, even if they had COVID-19. In patients with hematologic malignancy and COVID-19, again, adults more than 60 years did worse than those who were less than 60. White patients did better than those who are non-white, and here the relative risk was almost 2. So the non-white patients had a twofold higher risk of mortality. But again, very intriguingly and very importantly, those who had recent anti-cancer treatment, so amongst patients with hematologic malignancy, those who had recent cancer anti-cancer treatment did not have a worse outcome than those who had not had recent anti-cancer treatment. Okay, so again, recent anti-cancer treatment, chemotherapy, even amongst patients who had hematologic malignancy, does not seem to figure as a major determinant of severity or mortality. And if you look at the different types of hematologic malignancy, just out of interest, it ranges between 30 and 50%. And the worst sort of outcomes are seen in bone marrow failure syndromes like myelodysplasia, myelodysplastic syndrome, and acute leukemias. Now, treatments, especially for the lymphomas and leukemias and some of the solid tumors as well, can make a difference theoretically to outcome in patients with COVID-19. Now, many patients with lymphomas get rituximab, which is a B-cell depleting monoclonal antibody. It acts against the CD20 receptors on the white cells and virtually knocks out white cell B-cell function. Okay, and therefore, these patients would theoretically be extremely prone to infection and severe disease. However, it has been seen that they are not necessarily as badly off as we thought they would be. And perhaps one of the reasons may be that the T cell function, which is spared, may still be sufficient to protect against severe infection. Patients with chronic lymphatic leukemia, they have hypogammaglobulinemia and they are supposed to be more prone to infection. Okay? So these are the reasons why it might appear that patients with some of these diseases or getting these treatments might be more prone to disease, but all the data doesn't seem to point in that direction. A very important sort of theoretical concept is that the immunosuppressive therapy or the targeted therapy, which is used in some of these cancers, could actually blunt the hyperinflammatory response and could in some way actually be beneficial for the patient with cancer and COVID-19. So, for example, you have these tyrokinase, Burton tyrosine kinase inhibitor, ibrutinib, and there is another one called acalabrutinib. Now, these are Burton tyrosine kinase inhibitors, and they inhibit the interleukin-2 mediated T cell responses, and they also, therefore, prevent the release of some of the cytokines, including IL-6 and so on. And therefore, they could blunt the hyperinflammatory response, which is seen in some patients with COVID-19. You have molecules like imatinib, which also blunts cytokine release. And you have got Janus kinase 2 inhibitors like ruxolitinib, which block the inflammatory cytokine production. So all these agents could actually theoretically reduce the magnitude of the hyperinflammatory response and could actually prevent very severe respiratory distress syndrome, which is seen in some patients with COVID-19. On the other hand, you've got immune checkpoint inhibitors, which actually will increase the inflammatory response. So these are pembrolizumab and nivolumab, which are often used in solid tumors. They actually act on, they release the immune system from inhibition by and release and, pro, and prevent programmed cell death, and they could actually amplify the immune response. However, what has been seen is that none of these seem to make a huge difference to survival. Okay. So in myeloproliferative neoplasms like essential polycythemia vera, essential thrombocytopenia, myelodysplasia, this drug, this is ruxolitinib, is given, which is a Janus kinase inhibitor, the JAK1 and JAK2 inhibitor, very similar possibly to baricitinib, which has been shown to be beneficial in COVID-19. Right. So now, if you give this drug, then this will release, prevent cytokine release or decrease cytokine release and will work almost like baricitinib to reduce the inflammatory response that is seen in COVID-19. Imatinib is a small molecule tyrosine kinase inhibitor, which is shown to work brilliantly in chronic myeloid leukemia, as well as in gastrointestinal stromal tumors. Right? So again, this is a small molecule tyrosine kinase inhibitor, in addition to being a tyrosine kinase inhibitor and therefore reducing the inflammatory response, it also has been shown to reduce pulmonary capillary leak. And therefore, it was tried in a randomized controlled trial to see if it could be beneficial in patients with COVID-19. And this was a randomized controlled trial, which was done in 400 hospitalized patients in the Netherlands requiring supplemental oxygen. And they gave oral imatinib or a placebo. And the primary outcome was time to discontinuation of mechanical ventilation supplemental oxygen for more than 48 hours, right? And this was not significant. So it did not meet the primary endpoint. However, they found that the mortality was decreased. The hazard ratio was almost half. And it also decreased the duration of mechanical ventilation from 12 days to 7 days. So imatinib seems to be having some effect over here, but it needs to be tried in a randomized controlled trial and is included now as one arm of the Solidarity trial. So imatinib is being actively being trialed in Solidarity. And we'll look at the wait for the results of this with great interest. So many of the drugs which are used in cancer, or some of the drugs which are used in cancer, have properties which could potentially be beneficial in COVID-19, especially in modulating the inflammatory phase. However, we need to try these and make sure that they work before we act purely on theoretical and pathophysiological assumptions. Now, what is our data showing in all these patients? There's an early study that was done very long ago. And of 230 patients on active systemic therapy, receiving chemotherapy, and the mortality rate was 10%. So again, high, but not as high as was one in some of the earlier series. And again, in our study, that has been published, hematolymphoid malignancy as opposed to solid tumors did not predict for increased mortality. And what predicted for mortality was advanced cancer being treated with palliative intent, uncontrolled cancer, and severity of COVID at presentations. These were the things which were correlated with mortality. We now have data, again, mostly from the first wave, not from the second wave, of over 1,200 patients with cancer and COVID-19. 24% had hematologic malignancies. And all-cause mortality was, again, just about 11%, right? So not a very high mortality, but higher than what you would get in the general population, significantly higher than what you would get in COVID-19 patients without cancer, which would be about 2% or less. And advanced age, history of smoking, palliative intent, and presence of two or more comorbidities were significant risk factors for severe COVID-19 or death. Again, recent anti-cancer therapy, sex or cancer type, solid or hematological, did not influence outcomes. So again, in our data, hematologic malignancy received of chemotherapy does not come through as a significant risk factor for severe disease or mortality. Now, all the data that I showed you now was about cancer in general, in the community, in patients who are hospitalized, but what about patients with cancer who require intensive care or who are admitted to the ICU? And we tried to do a systematic review and meta-analysis of this, which we published in the Journal of Global Oncology. But the problem with this is that during the pandemic, many patients with cancer were deprioritized to receive intensive care. And there were many other patients. Anyway, the ICUs were swamped and they were completely stressed, and possibly cancer patients did not get priority, and therefore the numbers that you see in various case series are extremely small. And you know, it's difficult to get a large number of patients or even go to subgroups of types of cancers and so on who receive intensive care. Okay, so this meta-analysis of ours actually looked specifically at the mortality of cancer patients with COVID-19 admitted to the ICU. And we got 28 studies, and then there were 4 studies with severe COVID-19. And what we did find were the higher odds of cancer patients versus non-cancer patients of dying in the ICU. So just like we saw in hospital, even in the ICU, cancer patients have a higher mortality than non-cancer patients with COVID-19. The pooled mortality was 60%, right? So if you have cancer and COVID-19, the pooled mortality was 60%, as opposed to say about 40% in patients with COVID-19 admitted to the ICU, all patients with COVID-19 admitted to ICU. So not a huge difference. There is, of course, a higher rate of mortality, but not as high. It's not 80%, 90%, or 100%. It's about 60%. And therefore, we concluded the mortality of critically cancer patients with COVID-19 is not prohibitively high, and they should be admitted to the ICU. Of course, we should individualize the decisions based on state of cancer and other patient preferences and values and so on. But as a blanket rule, it should not be that patient with, oh, you've got COVID-19 and you've got cancer, so you're just, we are not going to admit you to ICU. I don't think we should do that, right? They have a good chance of survival. And again, the data is for subgroups is not very good. If you see the number of patients, extremely small, number of studies are very small, number of patients even smaller. But what we found on subgroup analysis is that patients who are ventilated have about a 50% mortality. Patients who are, again, based on 5 studies, not 28 studies, cancer versus non-cancer, they have a higher mortality with cancer. And patients with hematologic, only in one study had a higher mortality. But again, that's too small to make any conclusion. In our own ICU, again, this is partly during the first wave. We don't have yet data analyzed for the second wave. We found out of 127 patients, out of which 63 were ventilated, so about half were ventilated. We found the 30-day mortality was 47%. So that actually is quite good compared to the 60% global mortality, which we saw on the meta-analysis. In ventilated patients, our mortality was 67%. Again, there was no difference between the number of deaths in patients who had hematological cancers versus those who had solid tumors, right? So again, not much difference between hematology and solid oncologic tumors. And the only predictor of outcome was the change in SOFA score between the first day and second day or the first day and third day. So none of the other factors predicted mortality. It is basically how the patient progressed in the ICU that determined outcome. Another issue in cancer patients is vaccination. Is vaccination likely to be effective, especially if they've had chemotherapy and so on and so forth? Now, there has been data to suggest that it's not, but again, there are some studies which suggest that it is not as bad as it appears to be. And again, so here in these are the two studies which you see over here, that if you've got a vaccine, then with hematologic malignancies, with the first dose, the seroconversion is seen in 85% of patients and only 77% in this study. Right, but it's better with solid malignancy. So hematological malignancies, there might be a problem over here in seroconversion after the, and all this is with the Pfizer vaccine or the Moderna vaccine, the US-based studies. If you had rituximab, then this study found no patient had antibodies. So that's a bit of a worry if you had rituximab or anti-CD20 therapy, and only 70% in this study. However, if you had endocrine therapy for breast cancer or prostate cancer, or if you had immunotherapy, it was quite good. And the patients who had a stem cell transplant, again, the seroconversion rate was not very good. So there is a worry as far as vaccine seroconversion is concerned, but it's worse in patients who had anti-CD treatment therapy, those who had stem cell transplant, and in some patients with hematological malignancy. So finally, to conclude, patients with cancer at high risk of severe COVID-19 and death, patients with hematologic malignancies, and those who have received chemotherapy are perceived to be at higher risk. The data are not consistent. Anti-cancer therapy may increase the risk of infection, but may also reduce the severity of the inflammatory phase. Several drugs used in target therapy may be useful, but need to be tested in clinical trials. ICU care should not be denied to critically ill patients with cancer and COVID-19, and elective surgery appears to be safe in patients who've recovered COVID-19, especially they have to be asymptomatic at surgery. They have to be maybe more than 7 weeks after COVID-19, and especially if they've had mild COVID-19, have not required oxygen supplementing. So thank you very much for your attention. Please take care, be safe, get vaccinated, make sure everyone else gets vaccinated. And thank you very much for the invitation and for listening.
Excellent masterly review of cancer patients in COVID infections and immunocompromised patients with COVID infections. We know that immunocompromised patients like hypertension, diabetes, rheumatoid arthritis are very, very common, and especially in those who had cancer. Sir, very excellently reviewed, and then the problem of vaccination, which probably did not work because of the immunocompromised state. So, can I ask you one question, sir? that have you any data for the death of cancer patients or immunocompromised patients in the first wave and in the second wave? You know, we had a very severe second wave, and I think that had really a very great severity in those patients who were suffering from cancer or comorbid conditions like hypertension, diabetes, and everything.
Yes, sir. So at least in our hospital, we have not formally analyzed the second wave data. What data I showed you was first wave, but from a superficial look, it does not seem to be much worse, at least in the ICU and even probably in the hospital. But you know, it's all very skewed data because a lot of patients were staying at home, and a lot of cancer patients were not coming in to the hospital in the first wave, but they're coming more frequently with the lockdown lifted, they're all coming to the hospital. So the denominator has gone up tremendously. So the number of patients may have died, larger number of patients may have died, but we've also seen a large number of patients. So until we actually make that full analysis, I cannot swear and say that it was much worse or not much worse. But
right.
Superficially. And
many of the patients could not come to the institute or other institute because in the way the second wave was such severe that even patient had a lot of difficulty. They just died on the road as getting a bed for the treatment.
Yes. So it was really. We don't know what happened to them outside the hospital before.
We do not know.
So that information is a little sketchy.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. It's rightly said. So any other question, Dr. Roongta?
May I, sir?
Yes, sir. Is there any question, sir?
Yes, sir. May I?
Yes. Sure, sir.
We are experienced so many patients, those might, they are older age, but those get the vaccination first dose. Before that, they are quiet. And after getting the vaccination on day 2-3, they got high grade fever and we get COVID test and they get positive. Is there any experience or comment by sir?
So no.
The mortality was there in this second wave.
So we don't have data on that sort of thing. I mean, we've also seen patients like this who were asymptomatic, who took the vaccine, and then they got fever. And after 3-4 days, and because the fever persisted, we tested and then they turned out to be positive.
But even on second day also.
Yeah, but whether they were already harboring the virus and were asymptomatic and then they got vaccine-related fever and then that turned out to be positive. So, I mean, there are lots of possibilities. We just don't know what. And the second wave was so common. I mean, everyone was so. We tested in our hospital at least 30-40%. You know, at the peak, about 40% of our patients were testing positive for COVID-19. Patients coming up for surgery, scheduled for surgery, were coming positive, you know.
Yeah.
So right. Almost 1 in 2 or 1 in 3 patients were testing positive. So if one of them got the vaccine and they got fever, it's quite possible they were anyway harboring the virus. So we just don't have a definite answer as to whether the vaccine precipitated a COVID infection or whether it made it worse or...
Sir, so this is Sandeep from Muscat. Good morning. Sir, I just wanted to know whether these patients, immunocompromised patients, remained positive for a long period of time and they kept shedding the virus. And if so, were there any precautions taken or you continued monitoring them for a long period of time?
I think that's a very important question, you know, and see, in most other patients, if you were sort of 10 to 14 days after infection, you could actually be transferred out to a non-COVID ward or a non-COVID ICU, and you could assume that the patient was non-infected. But in these patients, we cannot assume that they are negative after 10 days or 14 days. And even then, you know, so our policy would be to test them before we shift them out. So we had to make sure that they were tested negative before we shifted them out and declared them as COVID negative. So
you were calling any CT values or something? CT values?
No, I'm not. Again, the value of CT values is debatable. What is the value of CT? I mean, at least in our hospital, we just said that they had to be negative. Although, if you were really short of beds, and fortunately for us, we didn't come to such a massive crunch, at least in our hospital. That then you could say if a CT value is more than like X, say 35 or something, then you could sort of think of shifting or not. But our policy was to make sure that they were actually tested negative before shifting.
But sir, our experience, many of the patients non-immunocompromised, they were even after 28 or 30 days, they were RT-PCR positive. So this was thought that it is not important after 10 or 14 days to get RT-PCR done.
So again, I think
because this was a very common scenario in first wave.
I agree, sir. I think, let me put it this way, we still don't know much about COVID, even after 1.5 or nearly 2 years. Now, the initial recommendations which came out from the CDC of 10 days and 14 days was before the recovery trial and before patients were treated with steroids. And now, you know, with everyone who gets oxygen, and unfortunately, even many patients who do not require oxygen get treated with steroids. And maybe that can complicate the matter and let the viral shedding continue well beyond 24 or 48 days. Now, the problem is that we know that the theory is that the virus may be shed, but it's a dead virus because it's non-viable. And it's only the viral nucleic material that you're picking up, which is turning positive. And you can assume safely in most other patients that the virus is non-viable. And even if the RT-PCR is positive, you can shift them out. And that sort of makes sense when you're in a pandemic and a massive crunch for beds, and you know, you can don't have to do PCRs for everyone and that sort of thing, and you can do it. So I guess even if the RT-PCR is positive, we just assume after 10 to 14 days that it's a non-infective virus and you can
shift. Very correct.
I'm not sure whether that assumption we can make in severely immunocompromised patients, like the ones with cancer or hematological malignancy or post-transplant or someone else. So for them, we are a little more careful and we wait for the to actually come in.
Good morning, sir. Sir, this is Vinay from Ludhiana.
Morning.
Sir, one query that you said that our patients may not have a very good immunological response to vaccination. Do you have any policy for third shot of or final shot, whatever they say, of vaccination in India or something like that?
That question, Dr. Vinay, is like I say, it's beyond my pay grade. This is being determined at the highest levels of government policy. If you ask me, I think it's time for boosters for those who received the vaccines in, like us, who received in January, February.
Especially healthcare workers, yes.
Yes.
I think we have a very eminent speaker, Dr. Ganga Khedkar, who was deeply involved in these vaccinations, vaccination-induced immunity, seroconvergence, the strategies, the boosters. May I request Dr. Dinesh Singh to introduce the next speaker, Dr. Ganga Khedkar.
Thank you, Dr. Rumka. Let me invite and introduce Dr. R. Gangadhar Khedkar. We all have seen him speaking on televisions and on different channels. We all know about him. He is a Padma Shri awardee in 2020 and former head of Division of Epidemiology and Communicable Diseases. He is the chairman of Indian Council of Medical Research in New Delhi and director in charge of National AIDS Research Institute, Pune. So we all know about Dr. Ganga. So let us listen him, and because he will be answering many questions which has been raised during the previous lectures also. Thank you very much. I invite Dr. Ganga to please take over.
Let me first thank the organizers to give me an opportunity to speak on epidemiology of COVID and the variants and the implications of the same. Now, one of the things which we all realize is the asymmetric warfare that began in 2020. The organism that we were facing was mainly spreading through the respiratory route. It was likely to give rise to mostly asymptomatic infections and also kill those who are weak and old. 1st January was 2020 was a day when the world was to wake up to a new reality, but it was followed with a comprehensive, enormous and a well-coordinated dynamic response in India. The first efforts were to create capacity for testing by RT-PCR. The first case of this particular infection was confirmed on January 30 from Kerala. And at this, on the same day, WHO had declared a public health emergency. And by March 11th, WHO declared this particular infection as a pandemic. Initially, if you all recall, the entire world tended to follow zero COVID strategy. Taiwan, South Korea, Japan, and China, they went in for a stricter lockdown. There was extensive testing, contact tracing, and isolation, which was also followed with closed or controlled borders. Naturally, lockdown was one of the main interventions that we could think of. But when you go for a lockdown, it tends to have impact on economy as well. Now, if you want to reduce the health burden, then in those cases, economic impact was also one thing which we had to keep at the back of mind. Second thing which we have to realize is when we went for a lockdown, did we go for an early lockdown or lockdown was done in a timely manner? If you actually look at the total number of cases that we had by then, on March 24th, we had only about 562 cases and 9 deaths so far. By the time we started taking out this lockdown, we found that the numbers had swelled up significantly, and even the number of deaths had mounted beyond 5,000 at that juncture. But the lockdown was done at in right time. And at the same time, one must remember that we could not stop the imported infection in the country for one simple reason, that it was very difficult to seal from an infection which doesn't respect geographic boundaries. If you look at what we did during the lockdown, the number of labs we had to create was humongous. No, we had only one lab which was functional until the end of January 2020. And from there, the task was humongous because you cannot isolate individual unless you test them and find out that they are positive. And therefore, even reducing the infection was a challenging task. Now, what was important for us, one, to recognize that within a short span of time, when we had a lockdown where we tried to ensure that the onset of this pandemic is delayed as much as possible in India, we found that close to 669 labs were trained across in the country. And that number kept on increasing even to this date. And today we have close to about 2,500 odd labs which can conduct RT-PCR test, which is a molecular test, which is a feat in itself. If you look at number of tests that we have already done, you look at the numbers, gradually we picked up the strength in terms of number of tests done. And if you look at the cumulative numbers, we have achieved a huge number of tests that have been done so far, and it became a successful effort altogether. Was that all that much easy? You know, why did we have to go for a lockdown? One must remember that the entire world was grappling with the shortage of RT-PCR kits, machine, reagents, swabs between February and March 2020. And the result was very much clear. You know, even in India, we found when we looked within, the manufacturing capacity for producing RT-PCR kit or rapid diagnostic kits, or you name anything, was almost close to zero. But we used this opportunity of delayed onset and the lockdown, and we enhanced this capacity significantly, and we became Atmanirbhar. It was not only with respect to diagnostic tests and reagents, but it was also related to the PPEs that we had to generate. We had to ensure that they are manufactured so that the healthcare workers can take care of those who are infected, and even frontline workers can protect themselves significantly. Healthcare infrastructure was another issue where we did not have sufficient number of isolation beds as well as ICU beds. We had to ensure that people are trained by telemedicine and ensure that they could provide care in ICUs, including ventilators. Use of ventilators was a critical issue. So different approaches were actually adopted to ensure that healthcare infrastructure is also ramped up sufficiently. And the impact was very much visible. Our death rates, which were suspected, people used to talk at that time that they are pretty low. They actually, if you look at one of the studies, it tended to show that if you look at the period when the lockdown started and compare it over a period right up to August, you find that the risk of death was dying by the period when the individual was detected as positive. Some people wonder whether the rates are low. It is also possible that delayed reporting is common in deaths as well as underreporting. But we had a time advantage due to lockdown. And also what is more important for one to understand is we could provide better care because we learned from the experiences of others. We also had lesser proportion of elderly in the population. And there could be an effect of cognate cross-protection of the immunity per se. It is very difficult to imagine what would have had happened otherwise if we did not go for lockdown. We utilized this time effectively to gear up and meet the challenge of the pandemic. By January 2021, we had achieved a lot. People became a little complacent. And then at that particular juncture, what actually happened was people assumed that this infection is unlikely to come back. If you look at the data that is available, the mask use had dropped from 71% to 61%. If you look at cell phone mobility, which is an indicator of how freely people were moving in the community, you find that the mobility had increased dramatically. And what was still worse was the number of tests that were being done at that juncture were almost close to, we had dropped by 40% at that juncture, and the result was imminent. On 18th February, one of the things which I recall very clearly, that we found that the small number of increase was being reported in the new cases that were being reported from Vidarbha region in Maharashtra, and the fear started coming back whether this is a resurgence of the pandemic again. And the entire story is very much known to all of us. Suddenly we found we landed up into a second wave, and the second wave was very sharp. It rose up dramatically. And what was also important is you have to look at that issue that for the first wave, the peak was somewhere around 98,000 new cases in a day. And that went up to 4,11,000 cases that occurred on a particular day. But the rise was sharp and it lasted pretty, it went down very steeply. And that's also another thing which we have to remember. But we continue to remain in the second wave, because the numbers continue to be high as of now, though these numbers are spread out only in few states at this time point. If you look at what is happening in the world today, you look at the daily new cases and infections, deaths that tend to occur, you will realize that even in the world, the cases are dropping, the deaths are also dropping, but they continue to appear to be significant. And therefore, there is a major worry that people tend to have that you need to look at the global epidemiology as of now. If you look at the number of cumulative number of confirmed cases that have occurred so far, India ranks second in confirmed cases. And when it comes to cumulative deaths, we rank third. About 50% of these confirmed cases and almost 50% of deaths that have occurred are accounted by 5 countries. And that's something which is extremely challenging and also something which makes one wonder whether we are close to the end of this particular pandemic. But when it comes to India, we must look at the total confirmed cases per million, because our population size is very large, and deaths per million, you suddenly realize that our rank is 135 if it comes to the confirmed cases that we are looking at. And when it comes to deaths, our rank goes as low as 127 out of 223 countries or territories where the data is available. But then the question comes, why did this all happen? Why second wave struck India very badly? And that was mainly because, you know, we realized that Delta a new variant had emerged across in India, and that's one of the reasons why the second wave was seen. And it's very clear that sometime in the month of September, the Delta variant started coming up, and it almost predominated the entire second wave infections per se. Now, let's understand about these variants. If you look at SARS-CoV-2, it has only 30,000 nucleotides. But it has error-prone polymerases. The rate of mutation is pretty low compared to that. But if you look at one of the issues, that we have close to about more than 100 million virus particles at certain time points in this particular infection, one thing becomes apparent, that emergence of variant can be common. But let's look at the positive side of the same. Not all genotypic mutations that tend to occur impact the viral phenotypes. Not all SNPs tend to favor the virus. Only those that increase viral fitness tend to predominate. One mutation that doesn't have a deleterious impact tends to develop every 2 weeks. That means a new mutation tends to occur every 2 weeks, which may have implication not only on genotypic mutation, but also on the phenotype of this virus. But at the same time, we must remember, it took almost 6 months' time for first variant of concern to develop, that is D614G from Wuhan virus as such. What is the impact of these mutations? You will find that they can enhance transmission efficiency. They can impact disease severity, which is less likely to happen. And they can also impact the protection from natural infection and or vaccines by generating escape mutants. If you look at what are the classifications of these variants, there are variants of interest, which means they are predicted to affect the diagnosis, treatment, and development of escape mutants to some extent, even the transmission. And when it comes to variant of concern, which is a higher category, you definitely have an evidence to suggest that either diagnosis or transmission or treatment is affected, and escape mutants may be generated. And at the same time, variants of high consequence are ones which affect all. But so far, there is no variant of high consequence which have been noted across the world. Now, when you want to understand about the variants, there are certain issues which we must also understand. Now, the virus wants to develop a symbiotic relationship with human beings. It wants to increase its transmission efficiency and reduce its virulence. And the reason is very simple. If the host dies, then in those cases, that's also a death sentence for the virus. And therefore, if you look at the matrix, you find that virus would like to adopt a simpler path to live in a symbiotic manner. Now, if that is the case, we try to look at what kind of variants came up and when did they come up. First of them came from called as beta. The second one was alpha, then gamma and delta. And please remember that delta is the one which is a predominant variant today. Almost of the large countries that we tend to know about, there are close to about 90% of the cases that tend to occur today are because of this delta variant. The mutants continue to emerge. Only a fitter, transmission efficient virus is likely to predominate across in the world. So where are we as of now? When you think in terms of the National Sero Survey that was done in the month of June, you will realize that the seropositivity in more than 10 years old population kept on jumping. This was the fourth National Sero Survey. In the first sero survey that was done in May and June 2020, we found it was less than 1%. And from there, it went up to 67.6%. People thought that have we reached a point where we have achieved herd immunity now? But you need to understand that we need to look at it from vulnerability point of view. If you look at the vulnerability continues to exist. Close to about a third of the population continues to remain vulnerable, so that the threat of the virus again attacking us continues to remain there. And that is at a backdrop that almost 62% of those who were part of this survey very large survey done across the country, were unvaccinated. And therefore, the bigger challenge is, now if we want to increase the proportion of people having antibodies against COVID, we also need to increase vaccination coverage very rapidly, because there were only 62%, there were 62% people who were not vaccinated at that juncture. If you look at the state-wise seropositivity in the general population in different states, you will suddenly realize that Madhya Pradesh had almost 79% seropositivity, but it tends to gradually drop. And in some places like Kerala, in Assam and Maharashtra, you find that the proportions are pretty low. And therefore, what you are seeing is in these states, the second wave continues to linger a little longer than what you have seen in other parts of the country at this juncture. Will there be a third wave in India? Definitely not at the national level. However, local outbreaks will continue to occur. Heterogeneity in drivers of the pandemic is one of the main reasons. You find each state is different in terms of population density, mobility, and migration. There are differences in adherence to COVID appropriate behavior, which will make you vulnerable. And there is a variability in prior exposure to infection / vaccination as another approach by different states, especially when there is another issue that tends to come in. How was the first wave? How did people behave in terms of COVID appropriate behavior in the first wave itself? There are three facts to remember to my mind. Reinfections are rare. Symptomatic breakthrough infections are also rare and least likely to lead to hospitalization and deaths. If I take complete vaccination and give it into the population, it reduces the risk of infection by fivefolds and hospitalization or death by tenfolds, which essentially means two times higher coverage in terms of reducing the risk for hospitalization and death, whereas the new infections that one can acquire if somebody is exposed to this particular virus again is dropping down only by 50%. And that's something which we have to keep at the back of mind. Why are we looking at this particular issue? There is one worry that if new variants tend to come, perhaps the ability to neutralize these variants is likely to be lower, the way the current experiments tend to suggest to us. Is there a worry of a strain where none of these vaccines that are currently available will not be able to protect us? Perhaps not. If you look at this antigenic space plot, all the vaccines, they tend to cover all the variants that have come so far. And these variants tend to require more than 20 mutations in spike protein for complete immune escape, which is unlikely to happen given the fact that the sites that this particular virus has are limited at this juncture to mutate and create an impact for a phenotype. If you look at the data that is coming from US for effectiveness, now if you look at this particular graph, it tends to tell you that those who are unvaccinated are at a very high risk of not only getting infection, but also dying due to this particular infection. But if you look at the three vaccines that they have, you suddenly realize that there is no difference in vaccines in terms of reducing the risk of hospitalization or death at that juncture. And this is something which we have to keep at the back of mind, that provision of vaccines is a crucial step that all of us have to remember. The immediate future of the pandemic is very, very clear. Now, if you look at this 2x2 chart, one of the most important things that the virus wants to achieve is peaceful coexistence, periodic and focal outbreaks, and finally, you know, it would land up into a space called as endemicity per se. If you look at eradication, it's an aspirational goal, mainly because sustaining quality intervention, adherence to COVID appropriate behavior can be challenging. Sustaining non-pharmacological interventions tend to produce harsh economic impact, and vaccines are unable to produce sterilizing immunity. Now, if you look at what we are actually seeing as of now, you find that the number of cases, the blue bar tends to represent the population that is vaccinated, and the black one tends to tell you the proportion, the proportions that are changing among those who are fully vaccinated, you find that the number of new infections that tend to occur continues to increase, because people will go out and try. If they are exposed to the infection, they may acquire new infection even if they are vaccinated. But the difference would be stark with unvaccinated population. But hospitalization and death, it continues to remain extremely low. And one thing which we have to keep at the back of mind, that even if somebody is vaccinated, if you look at incidence of breakthrough infections, almost for 5 months, you are best protected. After 5 months, perhaps the risk of developing an infection tends to increase by close to about twofold. What we need to do today in India, we need to provide vaccines to most of the adults as fast as possible, enhance vaccine-induced immune response among those who were infected before is a phenomenon that has been clearly seen. Vaccinated individuals, when they go out and expose themselves, they may develop asymptomatic and mild infection on exposure, but it is followed with a stronger immune response. We may move to local outbreaks, to endemic status rapidly, if we vaccinate all the individuals across in the country. If you look at our vaccination coverage so far, you find in terms of number of dosages that we have provided, we rank as number one. But at the same time, this is barring China, where there is not much reliable information that tends to come out from it. But if you look at the proportion of people in India who have been given completed two dosages of the vaccine, that continues to remain low. Now we have crossed a figure of 50% people having had received at least one dose, but we have to catch up. Though we may be at a higher level as of now, we need to be worried as to how we will complete this process of vaccination quickly. There are fears that there could be an emergence of new variant. But if you actually look at it, the newer variants that are coming up, they are unstable because the number of mutations that it tends to have are far too higher. Like one of the variants that is becoming more common, which is part of the Delta lineage, the AY4.2 mutant, that variant that is being seen. To me, the variant continues to be unstable. There is no evidence to suggest that perhaps it has certain fitness advantage that is conferred to it. And therefore, to my mind, we don't see so far any new variant that has come. So in conclusion, we have faced the challenge of this pandemic fairly well. The serosurvey findings tend to suggest that we may not get a third wave nationally. If we ensure high vaccine coverage for 18 years plus population, we may get closer to endemicity. And all of this can prove wrong if there is a powerful escape mutant which develops in some part of the world. However, it does not appear to be there on the horizon at present. The best thing that we can do is use the next few months to try and immunize as many as possible and complete their vaccination coverage so that we can call it as over. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ringa. We all agree that because of the lockdown, we could prepare our country for a fight against pandemic. As you have rightly said, in the beginning, we had very, very few numbers of laboratories doing the RT-PCR. It is good to know that we are having now more than 6,000, close to 6,000 laboratories which can do RT-PCR. So there will be a lot of questions from you, but definitely we are happy to listen to you. And your views, that there is a less chance of having the third in surge of the COVID. And what is your opinion about having the booster dose, at least to the health worker?
To health workers, perhaps there is a case to believe, but there is something which we need to remember. Am I audible?
Yes.
One thing which we have to remember that people are talking about third dose based on neutralization antibody titers. Now, all of us know when the body doesn't require to produce antibodies because there is no organism in it, the antibody titers tend to drop off.
Now, when that happens, it doesn't necessarily mean that the person is unprotected. Even today, the correlates of protection for vaccines is still an unknown thing. We do not know at what level you can call that person as unprotected or protected. It is also possible that T cells, which are also sensitized during, let's say, the vaccination or even for natural infection, you will find that T cells may mount the same response very strongly if it encounters the virus again. Now, that is clearly seen by one fact, that people tend to have least number of reinfections that have been reported. Actually, if you look at reinfections that occur after natural infection, the frequency is going to less than 1% as of now. It's only about 0.04% or some such thing. Now, what does it essentially convey to us? That if a person gets infection, he is unlikely to acquire a new infection itself. Now, that's a possibility that a new escape mutant may come and perhaps evade immunity. But to my mind, this possibility is pretty rare. Now, if people are thinking that this decision of a third booster should be based on neutralization antibody titers, and as has been shown that for 5 months, the neutralization antibody titers tend to be strong enough, and after 5 months, we provide boosters, I think we still don't have sufficient evidences to suggest that healthcare workers who are not necessarily immunocompromised, who are not older or who are not vaccine non-responders, all of them must receive the dosages of vaccine as third dose. We may have to still wait for some time to see whether the evidence tends to suggest the same over a period of time.
Thank you. If there are any question from anybody? Dr. Rungta?
You are muted, sir. Dr.
Dr. Ganga Khedkar, thank you very much for your mind-blowing presentation. Everybody has been quite benefited, I'm sure. On a lighter vein, I was
Dr. Rungta, can I ask a question?
Yeah. On a lighter note, I was reading an article and it said from country ABC, the most of the things, whether it is TV or it is fountain pen or an equipment, does not last for more than a year because it is made in XYZ country. So it is unlikely the virus which came from the same country would not last very long. Can you comment on this?
And I perhaps
this was very happy to read though, but I would seek your comment.
I shouldn't comment on such issue now that it's a national issue, you know, which can affect bilateral relations. So whatever we find should be based on evidences. I shouldn't speak on it in public domain.
Dr. Rungta, can I ask a question?
Sure, Dr. Singh is in charge, sir. Yes,
sir. Dr. Singh? Dr. Devetia, can I ask a question?
Dr. Singh is muted.
Yeah, I can hear.
Sir, yeah, please. Dr. Devetia, you can ask.
Sir, please. So thank you, Dr. Ganga Khedkar. So just to start where you were finishing off, do you think we should allow vaccination booster doses to high-risk individuals, immunocompromised patients, elderly persons above the age of 60 and so on? Do you think there is a case at least for that to occur now?
Absolutely. No, there needs to be some consideration on this particular issue. At the same time, we must, as I said, what we do not understand is if I get vaccinated, when I'm going to get mild infection or asymptomatic infection on exposure, we know that our reservoir of this virus continues to exist, exposures tend to occur. Now, if I acquire that infection, which is asymptomatic and mild, perhaps it's more like a booster. No, it's like something which will add to my immune protection we do not know whether for that purpose we need to provide booster right now. But I agree that if I would not be a firm believer that we need to provide vaccine booster to those who are healthcare workers, but I may still be willing to be open, you know, to think in terms of providing boosters to immunocompromised patients. We need to look for data.
Sir, I'm Dr. Juhi from Muscat, Oman. Can I ask a question, please?
Yes,
please. Go ahead.
Sir, I wanted to ask Dr. Divatia also and you also, sir. Basically, we want to know whether the immunocompromised patients who continue shedding virus and their CT values are low. So should we continue isolating them in the negative pressure rooms? So on that grounds, like what new guidelines are there like for those? Because we are struggling with those kind of patients currently.
No, I would request Dr. Divatia, sir, to speak. I'll come on that issue also. Because
so I thank you.
Dr. Divatia, are you there?
Yes, sir. So, Dr. Joey, you know, I'm not a virologist. I'm just saying what we do is you need not isolate them in negative pressure rooms, but you can certainly keep them in a single room. You know, so, I mean, that is what we are doing, or at least cohort them as they are, as if they are COVID positive with other COVID positive patients, if you can't give them a single room. Because I'm not sure about what is the value of the CT value in these immunocompromised patients. And like I said earlier, you know, the theoretical response is that the virus is probably not viable and not likely to be infective. But if you cohort similar immunocompromised patients or keep only that immunocompromised patient in a single room, I think that will serve your purpose of isolation. Yeah.
Sure. And the healthcare worker should continue taking the precautions like N95 and all.
Yeah, I think that's, I would argue that you should, as long as this pandemic is on or as long as there are local outbreaks and so cases are happening locally, you should continue to take precautions in the healthcare setting. You need not wear your extensive space suits and all, but definitely you should wear your N95 mask, gloves, and even a cotton gown when you're looking at any patient, including especially these patients. Because sure, you know, it's been shown that aerosols by patients who cough generate a significant amount of aerosols. So, you know, you're at risk anytime in the hospital when you come across patients coughing and so.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Dr. Divatia, you'll agree with me that we don't have the negative pressure room.
Correct. So, single room or cohorting in a same ward is good enough.
Yeah. Single room is possible, but it's difficult to get the, because there is very, very less number of negative pressure room. I don't think that we have even in thousands.
Just a couple of things which I would say is CT score is of very little value. Now, we need to remember whether the virus is dead or alive, the RT-PCR is going to pick it up. No? So it doesn't tell you whether the virus is alive and virus is capable of infecting. That can only be found on cultures. Secondly, the guidelines that we have are only for immunocompetent hosts, not immunocompromised people. If you look at one of the studies that was published was by Dr. Gupta, Ravindra Gupta from UK, Cambridge. He showed that for almost 100 days in a given setting where the person was found to have this virus, which was live, by way of new mutations that were getting generated. We do not know the end. We continue to remain vigilant. And as sir said, one of the things which we may have to do is to try and ensure that the patient is isolated to an extent possible so that it doesn't harm others. But we need to continue to follow use of PPEs.
Is there any other question from anybody? Thank you, Dr. Ganga Khetkar.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Let me introduce the next speaker, Dr. George Hinlago. He is professor of critical care and head of division of critical care of the Carl Husson Memorial Hospital, Religious City, Brazil. He is the Secretary General of World Federation of Intensive and Critical Care. His special area of interest is he was awarded highest recognition of American College of Physicians offers the members in 2012. So, Dr. George, are you there?
Not yet, sir.
Okay.
Will his video
recorded?
Yes, sir.
Okay, go ahead.
Well, by the end of 2019, the world witnessed the appearance of a new strain of virus, you know, the COVID-19, in the province of Wuhan in China. I'm Dr. Jorge Hidalgo. I am a professor of critical care, the president-elect of the World Federation of Intensive Care and Critical Care Medicine. And first of all, I want to thank the organizing committee of the World Congress on Critical Care of COVID-19, and in particular to Dr. Narendra and his team that leading and have this great initiative to bring all the awareness and knowledge that we have until now regarding COVID-19. In the following minutes, I will try to share with you some of the ICU challenges that we face and we are facing during the COVID-19 pandemic. First of all, I want to know that I don't have no conflicts of interest with this program and presentation. And the sudden appearance of the SARS-CoV-2, as we know, we have this, and we've been talking about the novel virus that came suddenly to our knowledge in 2019 in the province of Wuhan, and that basically was with the International Committee of Taxonomy classified as a corona viridae, and was basically put in at 19 because was the year where first this virus was seen and described. And as we know, basically after several months on the pandemic, we already have 243 million cases and a total of 4.9 million deaths related with the COVID-19. And this map, this basically is to illustrate the number of cases and the number of deaths by region based on the World Health Organization. And of course, one of the most important things we need to know is how we prepare to something like that, something that we don't know, something that comes and came so sudden. You know? And of course, to have a proper preparation, we need to think on what we have in terms of resources. We need to educate, because education, it will contribute to the disaster response. We know, of course, that the capacity and the capability of a community and a health system it will determine the preparedness in that sense. The essential aspect on preparedness includes that we need to know how assess our resources. That means equipment, that the human resources, the space availability, the trained personnel for certain, and the skills of personnel for certain functions, and of course, an increase in communication and the collaboration across networks, programs are critical and required. in that those aspects are definitely essential for us to face any type of emergency, but also the pandemic. The response, it will definitely require for us that we need to have an understanding of the emergency networks, the current analysis of the situation we're facing. And of course, that means that we need to try to identify all the stakeholders in addition to capacity and capability of the existing healthcare network to respond to an increased staffing demand, increased demand of resources, that and how we are going to address all those different aspects of the response. And also we need to know that in this particular case of an infectious disaster, is a very dynamic process that needs the flexibility and also needs and prove the fluidity of an organization, and these coordinated efforts must be collaborative. It's not something that a person can do alone. It's not something like a community can be alone, but it's not something that a country can be alone. It requires that we, all of us, comes together and trying to put all our efforts to create evidence-based protocol to ensure that we are going to have a standard practice. No? Also, we can ignore that at the same time that we're facing this pandemic, other disasters can happen. No? I mean, natural disasters, human-made disaster that will occur during a global pandemic. I mean, that is important, in the other hand, to have a contact tracing and early mitigation, especially in COVID positive patients, to help us in our response. The other aspect that is important is the healthcare work perspective, in that how we're going to protect our healthcare workers, how we're going to ensure that work at home, how we're going to assess and to help the mental and psychological well-being of our healthcare workers, especially those at the front line. And with that, I will share with you in the following slides some of the information that came out from the World Health Organization. And I need to say that this is coming from the World Health Organization. The impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on healthcare workers, understanding that COVID-19 has had a significant impact on the lives and also mental health of our workers. And in the right side hand also, it's important to understand that one of the most important things is the equity when it comes to the health work, no? And how the World Health Organization, as long as it's different organizations working together, are trying to close in the leadership gap and trying to be more create gender equity in the leadership and at global healthcare workers and force. I mean that we can say now that at an average of 115,500 healthcare workers globally are dying as a result of SARS-CoV-2 infection. That essentially put on stress and also to for us to say that we need to ensure that our healthcare workers can have a better access to personal protective equipment and also COVID-19 vaccination in order to reduce the rate of infection and also to secure that we are going to making sure that we are providing the necessary resources to our people in the front line, you know? And also urge the need of available vaccines for the healthcare workers, as well as boosters for those that are already fully vaccinated. The occupational risk of health workers during the pandemic has been need to be analyzed in several areas. We need to know the time of work, the workload allocation, the lack of recognition, including in the pay and the necessary resources, the prolonged use of PPE, and also the PPE that doesn't fit, the violence, the discrimination, the burnout, the sanitation and hygiene, in those different aspects that definitely we need to discuss, and we need to ensure that are properly addressed for our people. Prevention of COVID-19 and health workers should be based on risk assessment. You know, we need to try to establish what are the level of risk of occupational exposure, the different roles, the work task, the work settings. We need to plan and implement adequate measures for risk prevention and mitigation, and assess individual health worker fitness for work, when to return to work, including workers with comorbidities, you know, who are at risk, and they're probably measure the vulnerability and if they are or not fit to certain specific tasks. You know, those are the things that we as a leaders need to assess and to ensure. We need to try to organize work time and workload for healthy and safe work environment. You know, during the COVID-19 pandemic, we see that and all of us face that we work long hours without insufficient time to rest and recover. And that can also have implications because we can face chronic fatigue, lack of energy, decreased alertness, coordination, and efficiency, increased reaction, alteration in cognition, and also mood changes. No, I mean, we need to make sure that we can address that. We need to how we are going to balance that in a times that, of course, we know that is a lack of medical personnel and trained and also trained personnel, people with skills for all these different tasks that we face in an ICU. But also we need to recognize those that are in the front line, those that are basically working hard. I mean, we need to make sure that everyone get recognition for the work that and the time that are put in different aspects, not only recognize the effort, but also make adjustment on make effort that they also are economically also compensate properly for the work they do. And of course, as we are in the pandemic and we are evolving in the pandemic, also we need to make sure that we are trying to prevent the prolonged use of personal protective equipment. The PPE is intended to be used for a short periods of time. In the context of COVID-19, heavy workload and patient flows may require the health workers to wear PPE for extended periods of time, but we need to also see how we are going to address that, making sure that that our personnel are using the proper and fit PPEs, applying different strategies to reduce skin damage, that they are also have time to rest, and also ensure that they are properly hydrated, and also that they use the different equipment that are fit for each individual, and also use it in the proper time. The mental and psychosocial support is critical. We need to ensure that our personal and our people in the front line mental needs are properly addressed, and we need to provide the mechanism for early and confidential identification of anxiety, depression, of course, trying to ensure that health workers who develop mental health condition seek appropriate help and timely, to prevent stigma and discrimination as well. We need to ensure that also the necessary tools are provided to secure that our facilities have the necessary tools to ensure that we are going to have the hygiene rest spaces for our healthcare workers. No? We need to have restrooms, we need to have a properly drinking water, toilet supplies for personnel. We need to make sure that they have the spaces, ensure daily cleaning and cleaning protocols, provide facilities for changing, train workers in safe use of disinfectants, PPE, use disposal and adequate PPEs. We need to ensure that we are going to, we are protecting our healthcare professionals. That is critical that we definitely have all the different tools to make sure that we are going to provide our people with the necessary tools for especially those in the front line. Also, we need to make sure that we can accelerate vaccination for all healthcare workers in all countries. The data, evidence, and knowledge of healthcare workers that are essentially published, the guidance of standardized measurements, and also to report the impact of healthcare workers. The healthcare workers have commissioned and living and systematic reviews on education, disruption, adaptation, policies, the governance response, the impact on the health of the healthcare workers. Mean that the World Health Organization is committed to ensure that the people are needs are addressed at all levels. No? And of course, we need to make sure that the proper resources are allocated. And of course, we see during the pandemic that we live the crisis and the shortage of resources, especially at the very beginning, and we face it in a different scenarios, mean that as the pandemic is evolved, but also the due to the lockdown and the economic crisis, we know that we are facing a crisis of distribution and delivery of the different goods and different equipment that are needed. I mean that we need to make sure that the different people and the different policymaker peoples are aware and help us the distribution of the different necessary tools. The other important thing that we face at the beginning and we are still facing is the misinformation and the disinformation. And then we know that we are facing essentially that we call it the pandemic, but also we're facing the infodemic, and then how social media has been disrupted. But despite of that, we know that the scientific public health experts remain trusted among all this. I mean that the In this historical scenario, we know that journalism is given the role of herald of information for the public and the responsibility that never faced before. I mean that the dynamic of how this has been changed in some instances is critical as the evolution of the pandemic itself. You know? And that, of course, we know that the lockdowns that were implemented around the world as a strategy to control the COVID-19 pandemic that was needed at that point, but also we know that that have various advantages and disadvantages that affects economically, mentally, environmental, and many others effects that we're seeing the consequences and facing the consequences now. The other important aspect is the data collection and transparency. We need to make sure that the information is shared freely and with transparency. We need to learn about the decentralization of the information and that the different commands are essentially acting and leading with empathy, with transparency, also be willing to answer questions that are needed in order to develop the trust that is needed for the public opinion. I mean, this century has already seen numerous outbreaks and, of course, facing the pandemic that we are still by now leading, you know, who will say that in early in 2020 that by almost in this year and by this morning 2021 we're still battling COVID-19 that we know that came to stay and that we all of us together in forums like this one are putting all efforts to move on and trying to develop the necessary strategies as one world with all different countries together moving forward for the well-being of our humanity. I mean that with that, I just want to say that we need to continue doing what we know, thanks to the trying to keep our distance, washing our hands frequently, cough and sneeze with etiquette, trying to have ventilated areas and wear our mask as a simple strategies that been proved along with all the different measures and all the different ideas that in this forum we are going to provide and also to present some conclusion at the end to move forward in this challenges time that represent COVID-19. With that, I just want to say thank you to the organizing committee to allow me to be with you guys and to have the opportunity to present one more time. Wish you guys all the best. And we are in this together and we will continue fight COVID-19 together. Thank you.
Thank you, chairpersons, the speakers for the session. We have reached the end of the conference with 1,500 plus delegates, 300 plus faculty, more than 350 presentations. parallel workshops going on different portals, 8 of them. The nursing manual already in the hands of the nursing registrants. The update book is ready, will be available for downloading by the registered delegates and the faculties by in next 3-4 days with approval from the publisher. The members of the organizing committee have no words to thank all of you, particularly the faculty, the delegates, that we started with a very, very small possibility of organizing COVID meeting and have landed up and ended up successfully with such huge knowledge imparting educational phase. Senior members of the faculty, Dr. Rao, Dr. Devetia, Dr. Ganga Khedkar, Dr. D.K. Singh, and many others from the international community. 60 countries were represented. More than 200 delegates were from other countries outside India. And we had experience of almost 30 countries shared on this platform. So nothing can be more satisfying to an organizing committee. So I request my co-organizing team, Dr. Ranveer Singh, Dr. Lalit Singh, Dr. Rakesh Tyagi, and Dr. Deepti Mala to indicate to our participants, to our faculty with folded hands, to indicate to them a big thank you. Namaskar. Please join me, Ranveer, Lalit, Deepti, Rakesh, bidding goodbye. A thank you to all of you. If anyone has any comment to make, Dr. Rao, Dr. Singh, Dr. Jiggy.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Nair.
A nice experience, sir.
Thank you very much to
thank
all.
Thank you very much for giving up.
For giving your time, precious time. During this era,
Dr. Rao,
Dr. Rumda, I think what we learned in this was a collective experience, and that first-hand information coming from people who have, you know, been involved in the care of the patients and also those who have been involved in the various publication and studies was a great experience. First time experience for me. I mean, we get to read a lot in the literature, but knowing it from their own, and Ganga Khedkar, I worked with him in the ICMR, is a great speaker, and the contents of his speech or the presentation were very, very informative. So thank you very much for bringing all this to a whole lot of people across the world.
Sir, we will prepare a document in next 3-4 days. We will share with you before making it public, sending it into public domain. We will require scrutiny of the paper by eminent colleagues. And then we will make it public and send to the government of India for their perusal. Thank you so much. Lalit, you want to say anything?
Well, thank you, sir. It's my opportunity for me for learning, and what Dr. Rao sir rightly said, we learn a lot from the international fraternity as well as Indian fraternity. It's learning for me. In a very short time, we organized such a wonderful conference. It's because of your leadership, sir. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Dinesh ji.
Thank you, Dr. Rumka. It was good sharing of the experiences.
Thank you so, sir. We announced the end of this conference on a very, very satisfactory note.
Thank you, Dr. Rumta.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much.
Bye.
Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Diti.
Thank you, sir.